We note that any views expressed on Cayman Crosstalk do not necessarily reflect or represent the views of Compass Media, its staff, or contributors. Individuals who choose to call or comment do so at their own risk and should ensure that they comply with all laws and regulations, including those relating to defamation and privacy. Have your say on 233-1019, WhatsApp message 324-1019, or find us on Facebook at Cayman Crosstalk. This is Cayman Crosstalk on Rooster 101, leading Cayman's conversation.
Oh, land of soft, fresh breezes and budding trees so fair, with thy Creator's glory reflected everywhere. O sea of palest emerald, merging to darkest blue, whene'er my thoughts fly Godward, I always think of you. Dear verdant island set in blue Caribbean sea, I'm coming, coming very soon, O beauteous isle, to thee. Although I've wandered far, my heart enshrines thee yet. Homeland, fair Cayman Isle, I cannot thee forget.
Good morning, Cayman. This is Chanda V, your host for Cayman Crosstalk. How are you guys doing today? I want to say that it's going to be a bright, 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 sunshiny day, but I might be lying because it is partly cloudy skies with a 60% chance of showers and some thunder this morning, so I don't know about all of that sunshine, but we're going to hope for the best, and we're going to make it a good day anyway. I am going to give a big start with a big birthday shout out to Willie McTaggart, William McTaggart. I grew up knowing him as Willie, but I'm big man now, big man Willie, William McTaggart Jr. So big shout out to him. I know he's usually locked on in the morning, so just wanted to start our day off with some positivity. And for anybody else who has birthdays today or this week, we just want to, you know, give you some love because, you know, you sharing that Libra energy with my friend Lenny in here this morning. So, all right, I think we should do a giveaway. We haven't done a giveaway the last couple days. All right, birthdays. If it's your birthday, then please message me at 324-1019, and we're going to hook you up with some tickets from our sponsors over at Walk and Roll with some nice Asian cuisine. They also do delivery, so you don't even have to leave. If it's raining, you can let them come to you. All right, guys. So what else we got on the list today? We are going to be going through a little bit of stuff. There's some things in the news. There were some items around education. Reshma did an interview with Mark Ray, the director of the Department of Education Services, on Wednesday, and they were just telling us and breaking down how the schools are dealing with COVID. So we'll look at that. And then around 8 o'clock, we have the 2021 Healthcare Conference discussions. That's coming up. We're going to take a different angle on this. We're going to be talking to Gina Petrie-Ebanks, who's the director of the Department of Environment. And we're also going to be talking to Dr. Yvonne Turner-Johnson, who's at Baptist Health South Florida, as well as Brooke Moore, who's head of marketing and communications. She's their manager at HSA. So, interesting, and I'm looking forward to these conversations because I want to know how those particular, like, Department of Environment, how that's going to fit into our healthcare conference this year, as well as being able to hear from a medical facility in South Florida, Baptist, and many of us are familiar with Baptist Health, Baptist Hospital over in South Florida, that like lots of connections here to Cayman, but it's going to be interesting to hear from them what's going on in our COVID world and how they've been, you know, interacting with dealing with this and, you know, what the plans are, because our borders have been closed for so long. Yes, people have been medevaced out on occasion. We've done a great job, and I just want to shout out to all of the health service providers, all of our local hospitals and clinics and doctors and medical staff in Cayman, because we have been doing an amazing job of taking care of our people, except in the cases of maybe extreme emergencies when somebody needs to be flown out. I think we've done a wonderful job. So just want to big up the whole medical industry in Cayman right now. So we'll just take a look at that. And that's kind of like the general gist. It's a light agenda, but heavy topics, if you get what I'm saying, right? Okay, and just a reminder that if you are experiencing any flu-like symptoms, you can reach out to the hotline. That is 1-800-534-8600, or you can email them at You can email them on flu@hsa.ky. And the mental health helpline number is 1-800-534-6463. And do I need to give you guys a quarantine breach number, or do we have that under control? I'll give it to you anyway. 943-7233. So before I get into anything else, I'm just going to take a quick break, go to the news, because sometimes I feel like the news doesn't, we end up a little backed up when I take too long to do the news. So let me do the news. And when we come back, we'll get into some of this stuff. But remember, we're also streaming over on the Crosstalk Facebook page, so you can message us there. So good morning, everybody who's locked in already. I see you guys. Good morning. And you can also WhatsApp us at 324-1019. So if you are celebrating a birthday this week, if you're celebrating over the weekend, or your birthday just recently passed and you're in that Libra season, we're in that first week of October. We're in it. We're in October. We're in it to win it. Right, Lenny? That's right. So if it's your birthday, send us a message. We're going to hook you up with some tickets from Walk and Roll. All right, guys, going to the news, and then we'll be right back with more Crosstalk after this.
On Friday, the 8th of October, I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. The latest COVID-19 test results show that there are 5 new community transmission cases, all involving children, one of whom has been admitted to hospital. Chief Medical Officer Dr. John Lee, in his latest update, said the child was hospitalised on Wednesday evening. It brings the total number of local cases reported over the past month to 124. The latest results from 731 tests also include 4 positive cases among travellers exiting from quarantine. There are currently 132 active cases of COVID-19 in Cayman, 52 of which are symptomatic. As well as the child hospitalised on Wednesday night, one other person with COVID-19 remains in hospital. That person, an adult who tested positive after being taken to hospital on the 8th of September, was the first local case reported in Cayman in a year. And Governor Martin Roper, in a statement, said the news of a very young child testing positive for COVID-19 and being hospitalised will be a shock for the community. I understand the child is doing well, he said. I send my very best wishes to the family. The governor said Cayman was fortunate that no one is serious and that many of the current cases linked to the schools are asymptomatic. There is no doubt that our successful vaccine rollout has had a strong impact on limiting the spread of the virus, he said. We all know that vaccines don't stop individuals getting infected, but we do know that they reduce transmission and significantly reduce the risk of sickness and death. They are the most important tool we have to defeat COVID. For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Cayman Crosstalk is leading Cayman's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, everybody, welcome back. It's 7:09 in the studio, and traffic looks like it's flowing pretty smoothly. I was looking at the sunrise, and if you were up, like, early and just happened to be outside, I saw the sky was just beautiful. I'm just going to say it was, like pink, and it just looked like a little cotton candy sky. It was beautiful. And it was just for a moment, because, like, when I came back out the second time, it was gone. But, you know, if you just happen to catch those moments in life, be grateful for them. Just take a moment to sink it in and be present. And that's what you call mindfulness. Like, just, you know, enjoying the moment with all your senses, what you're seeing, what you're hearing, what you're smelling. I mean, you might be tasting something, but that's not always, that's very deliberate. But what you're feeling, like, just take a moment to really enjoy something with as many senses as you possibly can. So on that, I want to say big up to my sister station. We've been giving each other a lot of love, Rooster and Crosstalk, especially Crosstalk and Island for the morning show. We're all in here. We're all going in at the same time. So they had posted something on their Instagram showing that in their little breaks, they were watching what was going on Crosstalk, seeing, keeping up with what our conversations, the conversations we were having. And so I had to return the favor because I'm always listening to them before and after the show. So I was like, hold on, wait, we got big up them in the morning too, because, you know, it's a lot of love over here and I appreciate them. So big shout out to Zosha and Rico over at Island FM. So, you know, if I wasn't here locked into this, I would be locked into them. All right, guys. So what else do we got going on? I'm a little hyper. It's Friday. Like, it's been an amazing week already. And there's, you know, so much going on. Let me see if I can get through some of this because I do want to get into that conversation that Reshma had with Mark Ray. I think it's really important that we know what's going on with the schools. But before that, I just want to give a big shout out over there to the Esprit Retreat folks that we had on earlier. So I am going to the retreat and, you know, they dropped off my little bag because they've switched everything to virtual. So they, and they're, like I said, I know these ladies and they go out of their way to make sure that what they are doing is spectacular. Everything from who they're involving to what they want to see. Hold it. Lenny says, hold it up again. All right, so there we go. So it's the cutest little pink bag. I mean, it is a female retreat, and I am a sucker for hot pink. Like, that's my jam right there. And in this bag, you know, everything you need for the retreat, because they're going to have journaling. So you have your notebook. Like, ooh, and there's confetti everything falling off of it. So we got our notebooks. We got our instructions. Even, like, the little items to make the face mask stuff. All of your ingredients, because it's supposed to be like really simple things, like 3-ingredient face mask that's like super great. I don't even know if it's oxidized. I'll go find out when I'm there, right? This candle, and it was my son and I were going through this because he picked it up. They delivered it, but he picked it up off the porch because I was being a lazy mom. strawberry smelling candles. I had to fight him for some of these things. I love him, but he's well trained in self-care, so I had to fight him for some of these. I was like, give me my bag, dude. And this was the killer, right? Was the thing that shocked me the most. A yoga mat. A whole yoga mat. But let me tell you how, for those of you who do not believe the woo, that's okay. You can go on believing whatever. So I take spirituality as it comes in all of the positivity and the gifts and the good vibes and everything that's presented to me. That I was like, this has been an interesting week. Earlier this week, I said around Tuesday, I was like, you know what? I really need a black face mask. I got home Tuesday after the show and my mom had written a note on my desk and she left it. Your dad bought us all face masks. It was black. Love it. All right. So then yesterday, day before yesterday, I was looking at my yoga mat. I have a hot pink yoga mat. Yes. And I was like, oh, this one's old and it's, you know, getting kind of tattered and I really need a new yoga mat. Boom. Today, new yoga mat. So when you think it, when you believe that you can get things show up. I didn't ask anybody for any of these things. So if you don't believe in prayer, if you don't believe in manifestation, I said the woo, but I mean, like, spirituality is so wide in what you, you know, believe and receive. So it's in the Bible. It's in the law of attraction. It works. That's all I'm going to say, guys. You have to be open to believing that you can receive the good things that are meant for you. Do not worry how it's going to show up. But if you really have that deep, positive belief, and we're not talking toxic positivity or magical thinking, is like, oh, I want a new car, boom. Like, not that, but it's this is truly deep, I am worth it. Things will come my way. Everything is working out for me. Those kind of vibes, it's this really solid, positive things. It is amazing how many things can come your way. All right, so I'm going to leave that there because I don't want to get too much into the woo-woo, the spirituality and all of that stuff. But I did have to give a big shout-out to the team over there at Esprit Retreat. It starts tonight. I'm looking forward to all of the good stuff that's coming this weekend. Everything out of that. I think, Lenny, if I don't show up walking on air on Monday morning, I think I'll be like glowing and like all like guru vibes on Monday. We'll see. But yeah, I'm really looking forward to that this weekend. Okay, so also want to give a big shout out to our Cayman Islands Coast Guard, because the Coast Guard became official with the passage of the bill. So let me just read that. And I have a couple Coast Guard friends, and I saw they were like all dressing in their uniform and going to the Parliament. So really happy for them. So let me just read you real quick the update on that. The Cayman Islands Coast Guard, the island's newest law enforcement agency, has received legal standing following the passage of legislation this week. While the Coast Guard bill was passed by lawmakers on Tuesday, until the legislation is officially enacted, the agency will continue to fall under the auspices of the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service Joint Marine Unit, and its members will still be classified as special constables. Once the gazette of the official bill is complete, the Coast Guard will be an official entity in its own right, tasked with the marine enforcement of law of local laws. All officers of the Joint Marine Unit have transitioned to the Coast Guard, which is led by Commander Robert Scotland and Deputy Commandant Leo Anglin. Blah, blah, blah. Big up to them. So I'm really proud of you guys, and just wishing you a great service. You guys are awesome. Like I said, I know some of these guys, and that ain't easy work being out there on patrol on our Marine. I don't even know what I'm trying to say here, but you guys get the point. Like, I am just super proud of them. I am super happy for them, and I look forward to all of the great stuff that they are going to be doing. It's a good team out there. Okay, so I think, let me just double check. I think that's all with that I want to cover around just kind of like communities, the larger community stuff. I think so. So with that, let's just take a quick break. And then when we come back, we can get into the more deeper COVID-ish and political-ish kind of topics. All right. Because I see a couple things I want to cover before we jump into that video. All right, guys. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more Crosstalk after this.
This hour of Cayman Crosstalk is powered by Wok and Roll, the ideal place to relish Thai, Malaysian, Indonesian, and Filipino cuisines. For dine-in, take-out, or delivery, visit wokandroll.ky or call 949-0168. More of Cayman Crosstalk, brought to you by Wok and Roll, is next on Rooster 101.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
.ky. Stay aware of how you feel. If you start to have difficulty breathing or if you're worried about your health, call your doctor. For more tips, visit www.gov.ky/coronavirus.
Gay Man Crosstalk is leading gay man's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, everybody, welcome back. It's 7:19 in the studio. All right, let's get into this a little deeper now. Lenny, where should we go? Okay, wait. I have it. Never mind. We're going to go to COVID in a minute, but I wanted to just touch on this. We had the opposition on yesterday talking about the regen update because the financing deadline had passed on 30th of September. So it looks like the Premier's office is promising an update on regen as financing deadline has passed. An update on the regen waste to energy project is expected to end, expected by the end of this week. The Premier's office has said that the government responded to opposition's calls for transparency on the plans for the Georgetown landfill. So just want to make sure, because I just saw this one pop up, if there was anything. So said by the end of the week. So we'll just watch this space. So it looks like the Premier has, you know, the Premier has heard. So it's like he's acknowledged. So we'll just watch that space and look out to see what that update is, because some really good points were raised yesterday around costs and negotiations. So one administration had started the negotiations. The other is continuing it. So we need to, you know, keep an eye on that, because costs go up, investors back out. So some really good points were made around, you know, when too much time passes or you miss some deadlines, and especially a financing deadline that's in the world of transactions, that's a big one, because this is not like a $100 sale. This is like lots of money, lots of money. So we're going to we're just going to watch that space. All right, so let's get into some of this COVID conversation just super quick, and then we can go into the Resh Hour video and find out what's going on with the schools. But we've had, like, the last number I saw, which was, I think, last night's update, was 124 community cases. So we started this little community venture around September, like, it's been about a month. Mid-September, early September, just after, the 9th of September was when we went into phase three. So just after we hit phase three, we started to hit community cases, started to see the outbreak there. So as we go into, like, the weeks following, we've already had 124 community cases that we know about. and I've said this, guys, like, as we look at our neighboring countries that have opened, and this is managed COVID, so these numbers are going to be a lot higher once we go into the full reopening. And I'm just giving you guys perspective so that you can really prepare and make decisions as to what you want to do. It's not meant to scare you at all. So it's just awareness. What we do with that information is what's really important, guys. Okay, don't get into an analysis paralysis. Breathe with me. So, right. The reason why I want to bring this up too is because there has been a child that's tested positive and has been hospitalized. They're in a satisfactory condition, but this is kind of the first time we're seeing or hearing, this is the first time I'm hearing at least, about a child who's being admitted to hospital from COVID. The rest of the children seem to have been doing okay, either asymptomatic or mild symptoms, but this one is a little bit more serious. So, and I think, and I've heard comments in the community, it's like, we're very concerned about the children getting sick and, you know, anything worse than beyond that. So we'll keep an eye on that one as well, but it's already serious. And I mean, like, you hear all the hesitation in my voice because I am being cautious. I don't want to freak people out. I'm not trying to make you feel any more concerned than you need to be. I think we've gone largely to a point where we are accepting that this is in our community, but it's not to say that there won't still be a few more surprises along the way, and things that might shock us and jolt our emotions a bit. So I'm already preempting that as someone who, one, has to deal with a lot of media information, two, as a life coach and, you know, dealing with human emotion, I'm pretty good at picking up the feels in the room. So I want us to remain positive. I want us to do everything that we can to keep ourselves safe, to keep our family safe, to keep our community safe. And regardless of our personal choices, and I can't express this enough. You guys might be sick of hearing me say it, but as much as we can keep each other safe, despite whatever our views are on any of the controversial topics, that we have to just try our personal best to do our best for this country, because we all have to live in it, right? So, all right, guys. The other quick point was the rapid testing. They look like they're trying to bring that in by the time schools get back from midterm. So that should help us understand what's going on a little bit faster, less like where people's personal positions are, and give some relief on that PCR testing. So looking forward to seeing a little bit more about how that's going to work and the rollout of them. So they're looking for second half of the school term, and it'll help with early detection of COVID positive cases among students who would be excluded from school and given PCR tests to confirm the test result. So let me just read a little bit more of this. This approach would mean that in a case where a child is found to be positive for the virus in one of the antigen tests, the individual students could be kept out of school rather than the child's entire class or school being closed whenever a case is detected. So I think these are meant to be self-administered at some point. We'll see a little bit, because again, guys, this is like everything is going to be a trial by error type of situation. So and as new technologies, these new tests, these new ways of life come into being, we'll figure it out. So let's see. Just going over to Facebook. The people are sick. The children are sick. It's almost 50-50, symptomatic to asymptomatic. Okay. Thank you very much, listener. I just wanted to check, make sure there wasn't any comments coming in while I'm here rambling on. All right. So that was the last thing. But being that we have like a lot of the cases that we're seeing is being spread throughout the school, I thought, yeah, it was very timely for Reshma to do this interview with Mark Ray, who is the director of Department of Education Services. How are we for time? I think, Lenny, let's do a quick break, given that we're almost at halfway through, so that when we start this video, we'll be in a good position to go through a good 10-15 minutes before we have to break again. So let's do that. Thanks for bearing with me, guys. I know it's a little choppy this morning, but appreciate you guys listening in. So we're going to hit that video when we come back, so don't go anywhere. More Crosstalk after this.
This hour of Cayman Crosstalk is powered by Walk and Roll. Get rid of the cooking chores and give yourself a much-needed break by ordering Walk and Roll. They're sure it'll boost your spirits and make you happy. Visit walkandroll.ky or call 949-0168. More of Cayman Crosstalk, brought to you by Walk and Roll, is next on Rooster 101.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
On Friday, the 8th of October, I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. The latest COVID-19 test results show that there are 5 new community transmission cases, all involving children, one of whom has been admitted to hospital. Chief Medical Officer Dr. John Lee, in his latest update, said the child was hospitalized on Wednesday evening. It brings the total number of local cases reported over the past month to 124. The latest results from 731 tests also include 4 positive cases among travellers exiting from quarantine. There are currently 132 active cases of COVID-19 in Cayman, 52 of which are symptomatic. As well as the child hospitalized on Wednesday night, one other person with COVID-19 remains in hospital. That person, an adult who tested positive after being taken to hospital on the 8th of September, was the first local case reported in Cayman in a year. And Governor Martin Roper, in a statement, said the news of a very young child testing positive for COVID-19 and being hospitalized will be a shock for the community. "I understand the child is doing well," he said. "I send my very best wishes to the family." The governor said Cayman was fortunate that no one is seriously ill from the virus and that many of the current cases linked to the schools are asymptomatic. "There is no doubt that our successful vaccine rollout has had a strong impact on limiting the spread of the virus," he said. "We all know that vaccines don't stop individuals getting infected, but we do know that they reduce transmission and significantly reduce the risk of sickness and death. They are the most important tool we have to defeat COVID." For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Cayman Crosstalk is leading Cayman's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, every guys and gals. All right. So it's 7:31. Just let me give you all some additional information. Remember that there's a scavenger hunt that's going to be happening at the end of the month. It's family friendly. It's Rooster and the Cayman Turtle Center. They're teaming up to do a spooktacular Halloween for 2021, and that's happening on Sunday, 31st of October. There'll be arts, crafts, spooky Halloween games, plus that big scavenger hunt through the entire park. You can wear your costume for free entry. That's only for kids 12 and under, I think, the costume part, and bring your face covering. The map you will find in the Cayman Compass this Friday, so make sure you pick up your copy of the Cayman Compass today or over the weekend, and you can bring along the bring it along to complete and receive Halloween candy courtesy of Burger King. So you can check out rooster101.ky or the compass, this week's compass, for more information about that. And just wanted to remind you guys that there's a new product called Cover Safe that Signs of Paradise is has rolled out. I feel like rolled out. It's a film. A little corny joke for your morning. So you can check them out too, because they have this new technology, and I'm not a scientist. I can't explain it, but it's super cool. And, you know, it's like a film that you can put over your desk, your countertops, your boardroom tables, even like door handles and stuff like that. So things people are going to be touching, or, you know, multiple people have to use, that, you know, it'll help reduce the risk of the coronavirus. So check that out. I'll have a little bit more information for you on that later on. And I'm sure you heard the ads already as well. So, Lenny, let's get into this video on the Resh Hour. Pardon?
Hello.
Lenny has a call. Who's calling us? We're working. Who's calling us? All right, guys. So we're going to go into this video with... Yeah, he can't talk to you right now. It's a Friday, guys. It's a Friday. So... yes, we are going to go into this video with Reshma on the Resh Hour, interviewing Mark Ray, the director of Deputy. I think it's the way I have this written. I have director. I have it all in shorthand. So he is the director of the Department of Education Services. So Lenny, you ready? Press the button.
Mark, just a few minutes before we came on air, we got the latest COVID-19 results, and we have 9 new community cases, 8 of those cases being students. Students from, one from the Red Bay Primary School, the others from the high schools, John Gray and Clifton Hunter. First of all, tell us about these cases, what you can tell us about these cases, and what has now been triggered as a result of these new results.
Well, Reshma, according to the protocols that have been outlined by the Public Health Department, we have an agreement in terms of what triggers based on the number of cases in a particular class. So for education, importantly for us, we understand that if there's one case in a class, then the class is tested. And if there are no additional cases in that class, then the person who is positive isolates and the class continues on, because it's really important for us to make sure that students have as much face-to-face instructional time as possible. I know we'll talk a bit more about remote learning and so on, but the challenge that often happens with remote learning is that you don't get that opportunity for teachers to have that interaction with students, the attention, up close and explanations and so on. So as much face-to-face time as possible really is important for us. So if there is an additional case in that class, so the threshold at the moment with the protocol based on public health advice is 2, if we have 2, then that class goes into isolation and we enact our remote learning protocol.
Okay, so we've had the first case at Red Bay Primary. I think this is the first case for that primary school. What's the process for them? Are they going to go, the classroom is going to isolate?
Yes, so the first thing that happens is that the students then isolate, they get tested, and we await the results to see whether or not that class goes into isolation or whether it's only the single case and they return to in-person learning. In addition to that, we sanitize the classroom and any common areas in the school, because we have a range of cleaning protocols and safety protocols, really. Mask wearing, of course, distancing, additional cleaning and sanitization, hand washing, and all of these things are encouraged at the school daily by the principal and their staff to students. And we will make sure that those things continue, because it's really important, irrespective of whether we have one case, no cases in a school, really important that those protocols are maintained, because we enacted them from last year, really, last September when school reopened. And we've been doing that. We've put on additional cleaners in schools. We provided additional cleaners to support not just the cleaning, but also additional cleaning within the canteen area, the classroom areas. We've looked at additional security guards to help with flow of traffic. So we've done a number of things to make life as straightforward as possible for students to understand the importance of the safety protocols that are in place. Signage, we've put up screens where applicable. Not all of our classrooms, for example, have the ability to have 6-foot distancing. So we've utilized as much space as possible to ensure that the distancing can be maintained. The other protocols and guidance that we have COVID-19 guidance for educational institutions that was issued earlier in September, mm-hmm. and that is available on exploregov.ky. You can find it there, and it outlines really all of the protocols that we issue to educational institutions, indicating how they should operate, what is mandatory guidance, guidance for parents for remote learning, guidance for schools to prepare them for remote learning, mm-hmm. A focus on things like mental and emotional wellness, because when people are in lockdown, we think that's really important, especially for students who aren't accustomed to that. Our students have had face-to-face interaction from last year all the way through the mm-hmm. academic year. Mm-hmm. So to come into this type of situation now is different for them. Mm-hmm. So it's really important that we provide the support that, if they need it, from a mental and emotional standpoint.
That's a very good point, because I had that down in as a question to ask. So we can get back to that, because that mental health is a very important aspect of it.
Yeah.
But I just want to keep the discussion on the protocols, and more specifically the plan, mm-hmm. because when these cases started cropping up, how prepared were you, or how prepared was the department, the schools, the school officials to deal with COVID-19? Because it seems that you were taken by surprise.
Right. So from an education standpoint, I think it's really important that we recognize education when it comes to matters related to public health. We take guidance from public health departments. So we will do the best, we will enact the best educational guidance within the public health parameters. So from an education standpoint, we were very lucky that our minister prepared to issue laptops to all students, for example, to prepare for remote learning. From last August, we enacted a number of protocols that were done throughout the school year. So with cases coming now, again, from an education standpoint, mask wearing, that was easy to reintroduce. It continued on the buses all from last year right through until now. But in schools, it was easy to reintroduce that idea. The distancing, it was easy to reintroduce that idea as well. So I feel from an education standpoint, we did the things educationally that we were ready for. We had the laptops, we had the platforms prepared, Seesaw, Everest, Microsoft Teams, Zoom. So those platforms, teachers were very comfortable and familiar with those platforms to deliver education. So in preparation for COVID cases, we were fine. The reality is that we're dealing with something that is very new for the country. Every other jurisdiction within the Caribbean has been dealing with community spread for the most part. It is new for us because we've been very blessed and fortunate to avoid that. But now that it is in the community, the public health department has been working assiduously to ensure that education is a priority for them to address. And, you know, they've been continuing to give us good guidance, and we follow it. And we make sure that all of the good educational activities that we can enact under the public health guidance, we do.
Okay. And the guidelines. Now, you said you had some in place since last year, but you also released a booklet online outlining what the process looks like.
Yeah.
What are the key points or the key takeaways from those guidelines?
I think the key takeaways would be the focus on the students and the staff, their safety and their well-being. So importantly, first and foremost, we want to make sure that we have a number of tiers that we outlined. If there are no cases in the community, if there's a suspected case in a home, if there's a suspected case in school, if there's a confirmed case in school. So we had a number of scenarios outlined at the very beginning of the document. And on each of those, schools were given a set of triggers, and actions rather, to take on those triggers. Coming out of that, we established clearly that we have cases in schools. So we know where we are in terms of the scenarios. And the guidance then is very focused on maintaining learning, ensuring that students, staff, families remain safe. So what that looks like would be mask wearing, distancing, sanitizing. We put in additional sanitizing stations, for example, in schools. But then also the mental and emotional wellness, ensuring that we do the regular checks with our counselors, doing the welfare checks if people are in isolation to see whether we needed to provide lunches, because, you know, we have a free school meals program in schools now, in our primary schools. So we've been continuing to deliver to those students in isolation who would have been accessing meals. So all of those types of things we wanted to ensure that we outlined in this document, that our principals had templates that they could complete to make checks on whether they were ready for remote learning, number of devices available, teachers comfortable with the platforms to deliver the education, whether the necessary resources were uploaded. So the document really is a comprehensive document that speaks across the board, primarily about teaching and learning, but importantly about safety and well-being.
Okay. Now, we've had some changes from the time we had that first case on the 13th or around there of September to where we are now in terms of the protocols, in terms of the quarantine or isolation days that people are now required. And that was announced by Chief Medical Officer Dr. John Lee, a reduction to 10 days. What has the response been like to this change in the isolation, and how are, say, for example, the teachers who are in isolation, or, you know, for the students who are in isolation, what has that response been like?
Yeah. Well, we are guided by public health. So when we get that guidance, we issue it. I haven't had any responses back as yet to me to say, you know, yes, hey, we're happy, no, we think it's longer. But we take the good advice from public health and we issue it out. So our schools would be issuing that guidance out to all of their parents today, so that everyone is aware. And I believe, based on what has been sent, that it takes effect immediately. So we just follow the guidance as is provided.
Okay. So here on the Resh Hour, we like to get the community involved, get the community's questions to the people who have the answers. So we do have a video question that I want to take you to. We also have questions that our viewers who are live on our Facebook feed, they can send their questions and I can have Mr. Ray answer them for you. So let's first go to that video question and then we'll continue the conversation.
Sure.
My question is, why didn't they go to online schooling when they first discovered that COVID was in school?
Okay, so I think that's a question that a lot of people had in the beginning. You know, why not go straight to online learning? So tell us what was that, what involved that decision and why it didn't go that way.
Sure. So once we got the first case in Georgetown Primary, we again liaised with public health and they gave us the advice on how they would proceed. So based on that, the advice at the time would have been test across the board and we'll isolate all in the school. So we went to online learning at that point for that school. And then as things developed and we had different cases cropping up in different places, public health again analyzed the situation. They looked at across the board at how they provided guidance and we followed the guidance as they issued again. So wherever we have a situation where there's isolation, whether it is a class or even an individual student, we provide the remote learning protocols to be followed by schools.
Okay. So we also had another question that came through from the public, and I want to get to that question now, which is basically saying, you know, teachers will need to juggle online and in-person classes. Has consideration been given?
Hurricane season is here.
Teachers having to double up.
Yeah. So we've been looking at it across the board because when we have a single child isolated, I believe that's probably what where the question is kind of going. If a single child is isolated from a class and the rest of the class is still in person, then, you know, it is very challenging for a teacher. Various jurisdictions have been looking at blended learning or kind of that type of hybrid learning type of situation. We've looked at a range of scenarios, so and we're still exploring because we recognize that this may be something that we have to consider in the long run. The remote learning that is enacted now primarily for students who may have to be isolated from their class would be we use paper packs, for example. We use resources uploaded to the online platforms. The students will have their laptops, so they'll be able to access those resources, do the necessary work, submit it through Microsoft Teams or Seesaw or whatever platform the particular school is using. So we have mechanisms in place, but live video cameras in the classroom is an option, but we have to consider it in its totality. But importantly, I think we want to, as much as possible, within the guidelines from public health and ensuring public safety, we want to make sure that we can have the type of learning that will allow the child to be able to query, question, get responses, and have that type of interaction. So if that is possible via a live camera and some sort of feedback system, potentially if there's an assistant teacher in the class, it may be able to support with that. But at the moment, we haven't done that, and it is something that we are considering along with other options, to be honest. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I know, I think it was last year, this was raised for CCTV cameras in the classroom anyway for safety reasons and to ensure protection for child safeguarding. Has that plan progressed? Has it moved anywhere in terms of introducing CCTVs in the classrooms?
Yeah, so it's still something that we're actively looking at. I think we are a good ways along in terms of the research on it and the opportunities for additional protection, safeguarding resources, which would include things like cameras and so on. So we have a fairly comprehensive review of a number of child protection activities and resource people. So we are just at the point where we are recruiting for a lead child safeguarding officer at the Department of Education. When that person comes on board, one of the key things that they'll be doing is discussing policy with our ministry liaison person, and we'll be looking at additional ways, including the potential for CCTV and any other mechanisms that we have in place for child safeguarding. But it is something that we're definitely considering.
All right, guys, I'm going to pause it there. I had a question before we go to break. So what I'm thinking is, there's been a lot of comments, and one coming from our very own Lenny, just in case you were not watching the video. That was Lenny's question. Why didn't we start remote learning sooner? But I'm hearing that echoed more and more in the community. Like, as soon as we had the first outbreak, why didn't that trigger? So it's not necessarily a question for the education services. It's the question from public health, right? Because they're guiding the decisions that are being made, right? So it's on their recommendation. And a comment from one of our viewers, just let the children learn from home with a couple of weeks and no mingling with each other during the mid-break. Makes no sense to go on break to try to help reduce the spread, and then kids go over to each other's houses. The vaccinated parents are spreading it as well because they usually don't show symptoms. It makes no sense to quarantine one child and not the other siblings or the parents. Not rocket science, no mingling, just stay home and chill. So we're back to Tania Yad, just stay home. But that seems to be the sentiment that I'm hearing from most parents. And the wider community as well. So it starts to make me question what are we doing this for? So if we're going to be opening up the borders, if we're going to have to live with COVID, are we doing this for prevention? Are we doing this for suppression? Are we just trying to get a grip on it now? And then they're going to figure out how they want to deal with other things like reopening the borders. I'm just trying to understand what the long-term and short-term goals of this is, right? The other issue with the remote learning is when you're talking about young children. So I don't know. It's, again, a lot of trial and error. Not everybody has the capacity, whether it's financially or flexible work hours, to be able to stay home with their kids. So if you're asking for primary school students to be at home, who's going to be at home with them? So it's a lot of logistics to work out. So I don't know if public health was also, in conjunction with the Ministry of Education, looking at how do we ease this burden on parents and keep as little people having to go through this whole isolation process as possible. Or, so it's like, I'm seeing it from both sides. You have the parents that are being super inconvenienced. Even if it's remote learning, there's an inconvenience for many parents. And then you're hearing most people are like, well, just go to remote learning. Done. So how do we manage that? And to what end are we going to be using remote learning in the future? Because are we just going to go back to our classroom bubbles, or is remote learning really going to be the future of our education system? All right, guys, just a little food for thought. We're going to take a quick break, and then when we return, we'll maybe listen to a little bit more of this, but we do have our guests coming on at 8 o'clock for the 2021 Healthcare Conference, which is going to, our panel for that discussion is going to have Gina Petrie-Ebanks, who's the Director of the Department of Environment, and we will have Dr. Yvonne Turner-Johnson from Baptist Health South Florida, as well as Brooke Moore from HSA. So stay tuned for that. That's what's coming up. But first, a little break, and then more Crosstalk.
This hour of Cayman Crosstalk is powered by Walk and Roll, the ideal place to relish Thai, Malaysian, Indonesian, and Filipino cuisines. For dine-in, take-out, or delivery, visit walkandroll.ky or call 949-0168. More of Cayman Crosstalk, brought to you by Walk and Roll, is next on Rooster 101.
To bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
Conditions apply.
Gay Man Crosstalk is leading gay man's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, everybody. So I was just checking to see if there was any more comments that came in while we were on break. And that was a quick one. It was really quick. Let me just tell you what the vaccine schedule is looking like today. So Friday, remember, it's moved over to Lion Center. It is 8:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. and then 1:30 to 4:30. And there's not going to be any clinics on Saturday for right now. So 8:30 until 4:30 today at Lion Center, with a quick break at lunchtime between 12 and 1:30. You can get your boosters if you're in that extremely vulnerable list, as well as you can get AstraZeneca is available if you want that particular vaccine. So let's see. We don't really have like a ton of time left to discuss stuff, so let me just see what else is kind of just up on the news. But if you do have comments around the education situation, then please let me know. WhatsApp me at 324-1019, or you can drop it in the Crosstalk Facebook chat under today's show, and I'll read it out. But thank you guys for those who have sent comments so far and are tuned in. Let's just look back at this explainer of mandatory vaccines. So we had the opposition on yesterday, which was a really good conversation. And with the whole mandatory vaccine stuff, what I was having difficulty and understanding, and you know, I discussed this in the conversation with them yesterday, was this idea that people are being forced to take the vaccine. So there's two sides of this coin argument. I don't agree with the language of being. We're not going back to the video. Don't worry, guys. Or the live stream is cut? Oh, just the video. Okay. Sorry. Just checking. We got, like, so many things rolling around up in here. Okay. So, just on that note of, where was I? What was I talking about, Lenny? Lenny's trying to tell me. He cut the video. He's not playing the video again. I'm like, what was I talking about? So, right. People being forced to take this vaccine because of this mandatory bills. So the language that was used in our conversation yesterday was by the opposition leader was that people were being forced, which was discriminatory, and you know, so we had the conversation around that, and I don't necessarily agree with the language. I try not to use the words agree and disagree a lot because it leads to some major contention, but I was not satisfied, but I don't disagree with the force thing under legally that you're being forced to take it because a work permit mandate or visitors under the Immigration and Customs Border Control Law is saying that if you are someone who requires paperwork in terms of a visa, a work permit, those type of things to be vaccinated, no one is forcing you. Like, we have to be very careful with our language sometimes. So you not having that choice to decide whether you want to or not, like, it's not being forced upon you. Like, it might be inconveniencing you, but it's not being forced. You do not have to take the vaccine. We're not forcing people to take the vaccine. No one's holding you down and shoving it in your arm. So I get nitpicky with my legal brain on. So you're not being forced. You're being given the choice that if you want to continue to work here, this is what you have to do. If you do not like that, you do not need to continue to work here. And so, therefore, you do still have a choice. You might not like the choices. Excuse me. You might not like the choices that you have, but you still have a choice. So, so that word forcing, I'm not aligned with that. The other part of that conversation that was important was, what about people who kind of have been here a long time? So, under our immigration law, if you're working under work permit, if you're a student, even if you have acclimated to Caymanian lifestyle very well, that you're still a guest. You're not you don't have that, you don't have status, you don't have PR, you know, that's a different level if you really have passed that threshold, and there's guidelines in place for that as well. So my concern, and I'll just wrap up this conversation because it's time for our guests, but my concern around this is that, you know, we are We are causing an unnecessary divide in our community. And like I said, I'm already pro-choice. I understand there's reasons people don't want to take the vaccine. I think the vaccine does help, but I understand if you don't want to take it. Like, that's you. You couldn't tell me to do something I don't want to do. So I get it. But I'm cognizant of us pushing agendas that, either way, this is not an attack on the opposition or PAP government. I'm just saying in general. I'm really, really concerned with agendas being pushed either way, no matter where they're coming from, that cause disharmony in our community when it's not necessary yet. So a big concern that the opposition stated was where people are saying, like, what's next? If you're doing it for expats, then when is it going to be that you're doing it for Caymanians? And I understand that concern and I hear it, and I think it's valid to note and, you know, keep in the back of your mind, but that is not the concern of today. We have so many other things that are concerning us today that getting people riled up and getting people agitated and having everyone at each other's throats over a decision that is not even on the table, it just creates a lot of tension. So that's my concern. Like, that energy could be better spent helping people get jobs, helping people, you know, get through other kind of situations that they're dealing with, whatever it is. Like, I don't know everybody's personal circumstances, obviously, but I think that energy might be better served somewhere else. I accept that I might be wrong on that, but that's just my personal opinion. And with that, let me run my little crosstalk disclaimer. We're going to jump on Zoom, welcome our guests, and talk about the 2021 healthcare conference coming up next. All right, guys, more crosstalk after this.
We note that any views expressed on Cayman Crosstalk do not necessarily reflect or represent the views of Compass Media, its staff, or contributors. Individuals who choose to call or comment do so at their own risk and should ensure that they comply with all laws and regulations, including those relating to defamation and privacy. Have your say on 233-1019, WhatsApp message 324-1019, or find us on Facebook at Cayman Crosstalk. This is Cayman Crosstalk on Rooster 101, leading Cayman conversation.
On Friday, the 8th of October, I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. The latest COVID-19 test results show that there are 5 new community transmission cases, all involving children, one of whom has been admitted to hospital. Chief Medical Officer Dr. John Lee, in his latest update, said the child was hospitalized on Wednesday evening. It brings the total number of local cases reported over the past month to 124. The latest results from 731 tests also include 4 positive cases among travellers exiting from quarantine. There are currently 132 active cases of COVID-19 in Cayman, 52 of which are symptomatic. As well as the child hospitalised on Wednesday night, one other person with COVID-19 remains in hospital. That person, an adult who tested positive after being taken to hospital on the 8th of September, was the first local case reported in Cayman in a year. And Governor Martin Roper, in a statement, said the news of a very young child testing positive for COVID-19 and being hospitalised will be a shock for the community. I understand the child is doing well, he said. I send my very best wishes to the family. The governor said Cayman was fortunate that no one is seriously ill from the virus and that many of the current cases linked to the schools are asymptomatic. There is no doubt that our successful vaccine rollout has had a strong impact on limiting the spread of the virus, he said. We all know that vaccines don't stop individuals getting infected, but we do know that they reduce transmission and significantly reduce the risk of sickness and death. They are the most important tool we have to defeat COVID. For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Cayman Crosstalk is leading Cayman's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, good morning, everybody. Welcome back. So it's 8:04. The sun is still holding up, even though we're supposed to have like 60% of chance of showers and some thunder today, and they're going to be locally heavy at times. Let me just give you the rest of the weather update. Winds are east at 5 to 10 knots with higher gusts in and around heavy showers. Seas are slight with wave heights of 1 to 3 feet. And the high today is 89. The low is 77. So it's looking pretty right now, but I feel like that's a bit deceptive. So I just want to warn you guys, be prepared for the weather today. Okay. All right, guys. So we just want to... I'm sorry, there was a couple other people on the Zoom, so I was just trying to make sure I knew who everybody was before we got started. And just to introduce our panel this morning, we have Gina Petrie-Ebanks, Director of the Department of Environment, Dr. Yvonne Turner-Johnson of Baptist Health South Florida. We also have Brooke Moore, who is the Marketing and Communications Manager over at HSA. So let me push all of my buttons, and we're going to get all of these fantastic ladies on the marketing and communication. All right. See, too many buttons. I also have the Facebook thing going on in the background. All right, guys. Okay. This is better now. Hi. Good morning. Gina, I can see your mic is open, so can you hear me? All right.
Yes. Good morning. I'm hearing you very well. Can you hear me okay?
Yes. All right. We're good to go. So, Gina, since I have you up, let me just start with you. So we have the healthcare conference coming up, and we'll have details on that shortly. But we also, you know, when people think healthcare, I'm sure they're also asking, like, okay, how does the Department of Environment fall into this? So the doctors are obvious, but how does Department of Environment fall into this?
Well, I was asked by the organizing committee to give a presentation last night, actually, on climate change and building climate resiliency in Cayman. Mm. And I guess many people don't perhaps appreciate at first the connection between climate change and health. Actually, climate change is going to impact us across pretty much every sector in the Cayman Islands.
Right.
And we're already seeing some of those effects. But in terms of climate change and health, just quickly, I mean, some of the connections are that increased heat stress is a problem. It can be fatal in some cases for people who are vulnerable, older people, people who have pre-existing conditions, that sort of thing. And that is actually one of the predicted impacts of health change, even now, but certainly in the future. We've already seeing the data show that on average, we've seen a warming across the globe already of 1.1 degrees C, almost 2 degrees Fahrenheit. And that warming is projected to continue anywhere between 1 and 3.5 degrees C, and you know, up to the end of the century. So we desperately need in Cayman to keep that warming no more than 1.5 degrees C, because after that, all of the impacts really start to multiply and to become very much more severe. So I gave the sort of reasoning behind that, tried to unpack some of the science of climate change itself, the mm-hmm. evidence base for it, that sort of thing. That's why I was there at the healthcare conference, was to speak about climate change and health. And also in terms of health impacts, you know, we're expected warmer conditions are expected to increase, the prevalence of, vector-borne diseases mm-hmm. in the community. So things like dengue, malaria, chikungunya, all of those lovely, diseases that we all know about, and there are even sort of implications for the reproductive health of men and women with increased temperatures. So there are a wide range of health impacts. And then we start to think about food and food availability and the effect of drought, for example, on food availability here locally and throughout the world, as well as increasing temperatures. And that can have implications for the nutritional well-being of, right. of people and communities. So there's all sorts of connections between climate change and health, as there are between climate change and many other sectors mm-hmm. as well.
Well, no, and this is awesome. Like, this is actually really interesting. I would not have put those two things together. I mean, I know I get super grumpy when it gets too hot. but that's just me. Some people love the heat. But I can understand, like, now that you said it, I was like, oh, right. Like, globally, if everybody's kind of feeling those stressors and it's hotter and you're feeling just, you know, more stressed out, what is that going to start to impact on everybody, like the trickle-on effect, and we don't think about it at that level.
And mental health is actually another, issue with climate change and health, because people are worried, they're concerned. There's hurricanes. We expect more intense hurricanes, more Category 3 to 5 hurricanes, as we go through this period of a rapidly changing climate. So. There's almost every aspect of health, I think, will be impacted by climate change.
Right. I mean, and this
is already being impacted, actually.
Exactly. Yeah. And I was just going to add to that. I mean, we already know things like, you have seasonal depressions in some parts of the world. So you're going to start to see even just changes in different things. So it's like, as climate trickles down and the effects and how it affects seasons. So if you have more severities, it's going to look different. So that's really interesting, Gina. Thank you so much for for being a part of this conversation this morning. Anything else you want to add before I switch over to Dr. Johnson?
No, I'll let other people talk. I might think of something later.
I just want to add in today, guys, because I know we didn't have like any pre-discussions on how this conversation was going to go, but. I want to know about the healthcare conference, but if there's other things that we have time to talk about, I will happily open up the floor to you guys to just discuss. We have a whole hour, so if there's anything else you want to discuss that you think our audience might be interested in around your areas of expertise, I am happy to entertain those conversations as well. So, Dr. Johnson, we're going to switch over to you, and if you could just tell us a little bit about your background as well. You're in Florida, correct?
I am. I'm here in Miami and missing the fact that I have not had the opportunity to come to Cayman in more than 18 months now. You know, I've been on a couple of occasions and had the opportunity to speak at some of your medical conferences and engage with some of the media there before. So I'm happy to have this opportunity.
I'm sure a lot of Caymanians are missing Miami as well. So tell us just a little bit about what your area of specialty is and what you're going to be talking about at the conference.
So I am currently the chief medical officer at one of the Baptist Health entities, South Miami Hospital. And I've been at South Miami Hospital for more than 20 years. I started out working in the emergency department and was chief of emergency services there and continued even after I was working full-time as the chief medical officer. I continued working as an emergency medicine physician just because I love being a doctor and seeing patients. But I have to tell you, I have described the last 18 months since COVID started as the professional challenge of a lifetime. And so all of my time has really been devoted to administration since COVID started, because every day it seemed, especially for the first 6, 8, 12 months, every day was something different. We had new challenges.
Right.
We were battling shortages of testing and shortages of beds and shortages of therapeutics. All kinds of changes that were happening over the course of that time. So I've really, since COVID, been fully engaged in the administrative side of managing the pandemic in our hospital and health system.
Wow. Okay. So that what are you going to be speaking about at the conference then?
Without
giving us too much.
No, I'm not attending the climate conference. Mm-hmm. But I think I was just asked to come and update on COVID.
Okay.
My understanding is that Cayman was fortunate enough to kind of live in a bit of a COVID bubble for quite a period of time. Mm-hmm. And but now you're starting to see some of the effects of, you know, being part of this global pandemic.
Right. And I do want to get into that a little bit more. We're going to take a quick break, though. And when we come back, I do want to talk to you a little bit more about this perspective, because we are, as I have been telling my friends, Cayman has rejoined the pandemic, because, you know, we haven't had to deal with these community cases. And I think a lot of people, you know, obviously people are scared. There's a lot of emotion. There's, you know, just a lot of uncertainty. So it would be nice to hear some thoughts from the other side of the spectrum. All right. So we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back with more Crosstalk after this.
Crosstalk will be back to leading Gay Man's Conversation shortly on Rooster 101.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
Cold case. It's a phrase no investigator likes to stamp on a crime file. Here in the Cayman Islands, there are at least 20 such cases. Join us at the Cayman Compass as we bring you a special investigative series in partnership with the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service, shining the light on Cayman's cold cases.
It's a showcase of hot pre-construction listings, all under $600,000. Speak to developers, see floor plans, find out what's best for you. We have great opportunities from West Bay to Breakers. That's Friday, October 8th, 4 to 6 p.m. with nibbles and drinks. Join Century 21 at the Grand Pavilion Courtyard.
Gay Man Crosstalk is leading Gay Man's Conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, everybody, welcome back. The time is 7:18 in the studio, and your time check is brought to you by CIBC, First Caribbean Bank. So don't forget to pick up your copy of The Compass today. It comes out, it's fresh, it's hot, it's Friday. So let's see, we are just going to resume our conversation with the panel. I don't think I have any more updates for y'all, so let's just...
Crosstalk will be back to leading Gay Man's Conversation shortly.
Let's not do that. All right, got a little too excited in here. All right, guys, so we are going to go back to our conversation about the 2021 Healthcare Conference. We just heard from Gina Petra Ebanks, the Director of Department of Environment, talking about interesting ways how the climate does, these climate changes and global warming is going to impact our health. And we had just turned over to Dr. Vaughn Turner-Johnson at Baptist Health South Florida over in Miami. And I've been asking her now to just kind of continue where we are in understanding, like, just living with COVID, because we're going to have this shift. We've been warned that our borders will be reopening at some point in a larger manner than what we've been dealing with. And right now we're open to vaccinated tourists only with a quarantine period. And we tried to reduce that. We had some breaches, we had some other events, and now and Dr. Johnson, I don't know how far along you are in being informed, but we're at about 124 community cases that we are aware of in the last few weeks. This is just from like around the beginning of September. So, you know, that has, you know, impacted our community mental health-wise. People have been worried. People have been, the whole education system has been disrupted because it's a lot more in children here. That's where we're seeing a lot of the outbreak is happening in schools. And I just wanted to know your thoughts. Like, how is it there that you guys are dealing? Are you walking around with masks on when you're out in public? What is it looking like as you go around generally in Miami?
Well, I think we have been through that spectrum that you talk about. You know, in the very beginning of the pandemic, when none of us were vaccinated, mm-hmm. We really did find that we had to do some really serious mitigation, meaning we had to make sure we were all wearing masks, we were doing the social distancing, we were washing our hands, and that really does impact. That certainly reduces that transmission and you know, changes the slope of the curve of the people mm-hmm. who are getting the disease. So, you know, that was always step one. Once we started vaccinating last December and had, you know, a significant number of people vaccinated by, you know, March, April, we were seeing very significant declines in our hospitalizations. What changed for us, and probably as you're telling me that you're seeing more children get infected, I suspect, as was the case here in Miami and throughout the United States, was the advent of the Delta variant. The Delta variant definitely impacted even those people who had been vaccinated to a small degree. But, you know, we did see some breakthrough infections due to that. And we really saw a tremendous increase in the level of transmission among those who were not vaccinated. So the original variant had, you know, what we call the a transmission rate of maybe one, and any one person that was infected was transmitting it to another person, maybe another person and a half. Mm-hmm. And then with Delta, we found that one person infected was infecting maybe five people.
Oh,
and so you're seeing this exponential increase in the number of people who were infected. And we saw, as you mentioned, younger children getting infected and actually getting sick, mm-hmm. and younger people in general. So people who seem to be relatively immune from serious disease a year ago when we were, you know, battling this a year and a half ago, people in their 20s and 30s and 40s and folks who didn't have chronic medical problems, you know, they might feel like they lost their sense of smell. Mm-hmm. Maybe they had some sniffles. Some of them were totally asymptomatic. And then we saw a significant change with the Delta variant that people who were unvaccinated were getting very sick, even those who were in their 20s and 30s and didn't have chronic medical problems. So what we saw was that while the vaccine sometimes didn't prevent infection, people might get COVID, they didn't get very sick for the most part. And absolutely what we saw was they didn't die. Mm-hmm. And that to me is the biggest message that I can give to the Cayman people who are just coming into this, that we absolutely saw the value of the vaccine. Because, you know, if we had 100 people who were admitted, maybe 20 of them had been vaccinated. Mm-hmm. If we had 40 people who died, which was the number at my hospital in August, zero of those people had been vaccinated. So, you know,
yeah.
It definitely, the vaccine protects you from severe illness. It protects you from death. And I think that if we as a global community can really push that the vaccine is safe, that it's effective, and that it preserves life, that, you know, that's a message that can, you know, help keep a place like, you know, the Cayman Islands from becoming like we were in South Florida, mm-hmm. where we had so many people that our hospitals were overwhelmed, mm-hmm. that we were having to postpone surgeries for people who had cancer and, you know, we're going to require an intensive care bed and we couldn't provide that.
Right.
Because of so many people who were so deathly ill from COVID. So, you know, those are some of the, lessons that I can pass on and hopefully, you know, Words to the wise.
No, and that's very helpful because I know people were also questioning myself, and I forgot about the Delta variant traits just because you're getting so much information. So I'm glad you brought that back up about it going spreading amongst younger people faster, because I feel like I knew that, but then I somehow forgot it in all the massive information. And, you know, we're getting that outbreak in the schools. So that now makes sense, because I was kind of like, why is it mostly the younger people that are being affected by this? So thank you so much. I know you have to go in a second, but I do want to jump over to Brooke really quick, because she just wanted to let people know about the conference and the details. So I was going to jump over to her. So hi, Brooke. Good morning.
Hello, how are you? Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right. Just as a reminder, so the conference is actually going, we had our opening night last night with Miss Tina, and then today we have a full agenda starting at 8:30. So in 5 minutes, the conference will be starting live and will go until 5:30. So even if you didn't register for the event, because it's hosted virtual this year, anyone is able to tune in. So it's on CIG TV cable channels, their YouTube channel, and the Cayman Compass Facebook page. So it will be live streamed all day today, as well as tomorrow, with tomorrow's a morning session until about 12:45. Mm-hmm. So I encourage anyone to log on and watch. We have lots of topics from anxiety to child's health to alternative medicine. And tomorrow we'll have a really interesting panel about COVID, the past, present, and the future, and looking mm-hmm. at vaccines. So. And CMEs, I want to mention, are also available. So even if you can't attend the conference, you'll be able to download them on the website afterwards. So it'll be a conference for everybody.
All right, awesome. Okay, so you guys can tune into that, because that's happening right right after this, basically. Okay, and I just, before, while we just have a couple minutes, I just wanted to go back to Dr. Johnson just very quickly, because I know she has to leave us 8:30. So I just wanted to open up and just ask you if there was anything else you wanted to add to the conversation about COVID. I'm just trying to think if there was anything specific. Generally, what's the quality of life over there like in Miami, just on the non-medical side, like when you're just around? What's it like at this point today?
Well, we're definitely better than we were, I'd say, a year ago. Mm-hmm. So among those of us who are vaccinated, I think we feel very safe being outside. That's another thing that we've learned, that the virus doesn't transmit very easily outdoors. Okay. So if you are getting together with people, if you are, you know, wanting to socialize, the safest mm-hmm. thing is to, you know, plan that outdoors. And, you know, there's nowhere more beautiful than the Caymans to be outside and enjoying the environment.
Endless summer barbecues.
So, okay. You know, the ocean breeze, all of that helps mitigate against transmission. Okay. When you go inside, you know, we recommend that you wear masks if you're with folks who are not kind of part of your family bubble. Mm-hmm. So if you're with a lot of different people, you know, the safest thing is to wear a mask, and, you know, my mask protects you and your mask protects me. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the whole idea of this being a community effort, and trying to get away from the concept that, you know, I'm making this decision purely for myself, because this really is a community, affliction, mm-hmm. you know, if the fact that I might not get very sick from it doesn't mean that I'm not going to transmit it to somebody else who could get very sick. And then, you know, you have limited resources from a medical standpoint. So, you know, I might not need to be hospitalized for COVID, mm-hmm. but, you know, if I have a heart attack or my grandmother has a heart attack, she's going to need those resources at the hospital that, you know, if they're all being utilized for, you know, folks who were not vigilant against this virus, you know, as a community, we're affected. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I really want to get that message out, that while, you know, a lot of the debate about this is about our own personal choices to decide whether or not we're going to, you know, make decisions that affect us, that we really recognize that those personal decisions affect us as a community.
Yeah.
And particularly in a place you know, like the Cayman, that is, you know, so tight knit. You know, everybody's got to depend on each other to, mm-hmm. you know, to raise the bar. And it sounds like you all did that for yeah. a great extent for a long time.
Yeah. And I think we're
but
doing
the Delta variant's still doing well. Another thing.
Yeah. And the variants to come possibly as well. So I do think we have to stay vigilant on that. And I do, and you know what, as much as there's been a lot of tension in our community, I do want to take 1 second to say that I think we are still doing a really great job. Even if we're at each other's throats a little bit right now, we have still done well, Cayman. So good job.
Very good.
So Dr. Johnson, thank you so much for joining us. I know you have to go. I'm going to just hang on with Brooke and Gina for a few more minutes if they can indulge me. I do want to talk to Gina about the turtles because I've been like hearing so much about the turtles. So I want to get a little bit of an update about the turtles as well. And then Brooke can also just give us any more additional information about the conference if she sees fit. But we're going to take a quick break and then when we come back, we'll have those conversations. All right, guys, more crosstalk after this.
Thanks for having me.
Pizza Hut has kids and adults covered with great dine-in deals at the 7 Mile Beach location. From Monday to
when it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
Of October. I'm Caroline James with your headlines from the Cayman Compass newsroom. The latest COVID-19 test results show that there are 5 new community transmission cases, all involving children, one of whom has been admitted to hospital. Chief Medical Officer Dr. John Lee in his latest update said the child was hospitalized on Wednesday evening. It brings the total number of local cases reported over the past month to 124. The latest results from 731 tests also include 4 positive cases among travellers exiting from quarantine. There are currently 132 active cases of COVID-19 in Cayman, 52 of which are symptomatic. As well as the child hospitalised on Wednesday night, one other person with COVID-19 remains in hospital. That person, an adult who tested positive after being taken to hospital on the 8th of September, was the first local case reported in Cayman in a year. And Governor Martin Roper, in a statement, said the news of a very young child testing positive for COVID-19 and being hospitalised will be a shock for the community. I understand the child is doing well, he said. I send my very best wishes to the family. The governor said Cayman was fortunate that no one is seriously ill from the virus and that many of the current cases linked to the schools are asymptomatic. There is no doubt that our successful vaccine rollout has had a strong impact on limiting the spread of the virus, he said. We all know that vaccines don't stop individuals getting infected, but we do know that they reduce transmission and significantly reduce the risk of sickness and death. They are the most important tool we have to defeat COVID. For these and other of the nation's top headlines, visit caymancompass.com.
Cayman Crosstalk is leading Cayman's conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
All right, everybody, welcome back. So the time in studio is 8:33, and we're just wrapping up our conversation with Brooke Moore of HSA, and we also have Gina Petrie-Ebanks, Director of the Department of Environment, with us. And we mostly covered the health care the Health Conference 2021. Brooke, I'll just go to you real quick if there was anything else you wanted to add or sponsor. I know there's like a heavy hitting program, so I don't want to keep you guys any longer than necessary, but I'll just give you the opportunity to add anything else or thank your sponsors and let us know who else was involved.
We can't hear you.
Oh, thanks for letting me know, Gina.
Sorry, I was just about to put it in the chat.
I'm like, why are they just looking at me like that? Why are they just staring at me?
I could see you were talking, but I wasn't hearing anything.
It's Friday. Okay, so I was just asking Brooke if there was anything else she wanted to mention, or if there were sponsors or anyone she needed to thank before we wrapped up. I didn't want to keep you guys super long. Worries. I know it's a busy day.
No worries. I just want to say thank you to the Ministry of Health and Wellness, because this is their annual conference and this is our 12th year. And it's because of our sponsors that we're able to still host this free every year to the public, even when it is in person. Mm-hmm. This year's title sponsor is Health City Cayman Islands. Our Premium Plus sponsor is Doctors Hospital. Premium sponsors is HSA, Integra Healthcare, Aster Cayman Med City, and Kelly Holding. And major sponsors, Dart and Compass Media. I have a few more. I get my housekeeping in.
Yeah.
Cineco, Baptist Health, Infinite Mind Care, Marsh, the Wellness Center, Public Health, Progressive Distributors, 3T MRI, and Ocean Med. Mm-hmm. And again, we wouldn't be able to hold this conference every year without their support. And a lot of those sponsors actually have some fantastic speakers on the lineup as well. Yeah. If you need to see the agenda, you can go to healthcareconference.ky. Mm-hmm. Again, it will be running all day today. It should be starting just now, and we'll be going till 5:30. And then we have a half day tomorrow as well.
Okay.
And even if you aren't able to watch it live on CIGTV or Compass Media Facebook page, all of the video will be available after the conference on the CIGTV YouTube channel. So if you aren't able to watch it live, you'll still be able to watch it anytime thereafter.
Okay. I've dropped the link in today's chat as well so that any of our listeners can find it quite easily. And you mentioned 3T MRI, and I was thinking Dr. Ratto because of the whole COVID conversations. We've had some interesting conversations with him over the last few weeks, and he said something, and it stuck with me with where we're at with the community. And he said, not everybody's infected, but everybody's affected. And I was like, wow, that really stuck with me, that it is definitely it takes the whole village to get through this issue. So even if we're not infected, we will be affected in one way or the other. So
And this year's theme is breathe easier. Mm-hmm. And we came up with that theme earlier in the year because we were in that stage where we were breathing easier in metaphorically and literally a bit more so than a year ago after coming out of lockdown. And now we're going to this more virtual. It's kind of shifted, but interestingly enough, the topics aren't just about breathing, although the first presentation this morning is about respiratory health. Mm-hmm. But also breathing easier with your mind. There's going to be topics on mental health. Mm-hmm. And the stigma and anxiety and child health. And so it's looking at how to breathe easier throughout your life, and mm-hmm. And whether it be COVID or mentally. So there's really a topic for everybody.
Right. Yeah. So that's awesome. I'm looking forward to the mental health stuff, and even stuff I didn't know that I was looking forward to, like things like what Gina's talking about and how climate change, like that one blew my mind because it seems obvious, but it's so not obvious at the same time. It's like, yeah, when you really think about it, it makes a ton of sense. So, all right, ladies, I don't know if there's anything else you guys want to add around the healthcare conference, but Gina, if there was anything else. Otherwise, I want to just have Gina just talk to me a little bit about the turtles. I'm not going to put her in too much pressure because I didn't prepare her for that. But I just heard so many good things. But is there anything else around the healthcare conference that you guys need to mention? Nope. No, Brooke? Okay.
All right. I could go into detail on all the speakers, but like I said, you'll be able to watch them live, and all the information is on healthcareconference.ky.
All right. Awesome. Okay. Well, Brooke, I will let you go because I know it's a busy, busy day for you guys with all this, with the conference going on.
No problem.
And I'll just ask Gina to stay with me for just a few minutes, just maybe 5 minutes, and
thank you for having
indulge
us.
Me a little bit. All right. Thank
Bye.
You, Brooke. Bye. Have a great day.
Bye.
All right, Gina. So I was, again, not to put you on the spot, but I was hearing a lot of good things. I hear, like, you know, my friends, and I've seen things on social media with people doing their turtle track walks, and I think Anique Jackman, I don't think she minds me calling it out because she put it out there publicly that, you know, she was walking. There had been a recent release and she didn't have her camera at the time. And, you know, but she did end up seeing it and she shared a moment and somebody else was on the beach and captured it and I think shared it with her. So there's just like a lot of sense of Cayman pride with taking care of these turtles in the community. So I was just kind of just wondering where we were at, if you had just had any summary you want to give us, or just the impact that community is making on this.
I don't have any recent up-to-date data on nest numbers this year. Mm-hmm. What I do know is that this year has been a slower year for us than mm-hmm. last year for nesting. But that's normal. Sometimes turtles don't come back to nest every year. They take a year off. And mm-hmm. so this may be one of those years where some of the turtles haven't come back to nest. Mm-hmm. And then next year we may be in another bumper year. Mm-hmm. But generally speaking, I mean, our program, which has been running now for 21 years, I think, mm-hmm. In terms of our monitoring of our nesting beaches, it's a great example of community participation. And we have a lot of volunteers who walk stretches of beaches for us. Mm-hmm. We've had the donation of an app from some members of our community, actually, the lady Lori, who sort of coordinates our volunteer effort. Her husband and her developed this app for us that we can actually take the data of nest locations, all of the information that we need in real time, which makes it really a lot easier for us to coordinate our information, et cetera. So, and we have a team of our core team people that actually will go and check each nest, verify that it's a nest, make sure we have the location, and then we will obviously go back when it's hatched and check mm-hmm. that what the hatching success was, for example, and just get all of the data that we need to help us make decisions about how to best protect our sea turtles going forward. So mm-hmm. we also have a conservation plan under the National Conservation Act for sea turtles that we're going to be, it went out to public consultation already, and we're taking it now to cabinet for final endorsement. And hopefully that will help us be in a position to better manage some of the threats to sea turtles that you might not even normally think of, things like driving on the beach, for example. Mm-hmm. Vehicle tracks, vehicles themselves, if they're heavy enough, can crush nests. Mm-hmm. And then vehicle tracks are also a problem because when the juvenile turtles come out of the nests, the hatchlings, they get stuck. Even a track that is running parallel to the shoreline, they sometimes get stuck. They can't get out of the deep grooves that tracks create. Bonfire is another thing that will sometimes we've had a few nests cooked by bonfires. Oh, inadvertently, gosh. People yeah. didn't know that there were nests there, you know.
So how do you protect, like, once you find the nest, like, is there any kind of warning or signage that's put up for people?
Generally not, right. Unless it's really something that we want to signal to people all the time. Mm-hmm. But what we've done is we've put in place, for example, with the Department of Environmental Health, anybody who's doing a bonfire on the beach, for example, needs to get permission from them. Okay. So they consult with us and we're able to say yes or no in terms of whether we've had
any sightings,
any nests in the right. location that they yeah. want to have their bonfire. And the same is true if somebody needs to have heavy equipment on the beach. Say we have a sargassum influx, which mm-hmm. happens quite a lot during turtle nesting season. We're able then to say, your stretch of beach is clear, right. or actually you need to be really careful. And then at that point, we may go out and sort of indicate where the nests are, in some way, marking them in some way, okay. that sort of thing. So, And because we have all the data and all the nest locations, it makes that consultation very quick and very easy for us. Mm-hmm. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And then one other piece of information I just wanted to clarify. If memory serves me, turtle genders are also affected by temperature?
That's correct. Okay. So temperature of turtles are actually determined by the incubation temperature in the nest. Uh-huh. And with climate change, with warming temperatures, what the prediction is that there will be less male turtles produced because of the higher temperatures.
Okay. Okay. All right. So I remembered. Yeah. I remembered my yes, turtle knowledge. But again, another reason why we have to also keep an eye on what's going on climate-wise.
Climate change is going to affect the range of a lot of our species. It's actually pretty alarming. I mean, coral reefs, obviously, we know they bleach when sea surface temperatures increase just by 1 degree C.
Right.
So we're already seeing bleaching, and we're going to have to expect to see more of that as temperatures rise. Hopefully in COP26 this year, countries will really take on board the warning that the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, has signaled with the publication of their report just in August of this year, which basically says, you know, it is now unequivocal that it is human influence that is causing the warming of our planet, that is causing these large shifts in global climate patterns. And it's pretty dire, and it is very urgent that really deep emission cuts happen, and that we get to net zero emissions actually by mid-century if we want to keep this warming to 1.5 degrees. And having said that, there are things like sea level rise, for example, where we have many, many years, centuries of sea level rise locked in because of the change in the climate that we're already seeing. So, but we can minimize the amount of sea level rise by cutting, you know, these deep cuts in emissions, and other aspects of the climate system will respond faster. But the sea level rise, we've got some serious climate change.
Well, I am a big
inflicted impacts locked in already.
Yeah, I'm a big advocate for, you know, increasing our public transportation system and bettering that and making those improvements. I did see an article on, LinkedIn that was written recently. So I was just like, yep, we do really need to get on track with that. That will help. So anywhere we can, but yes, great points. I also, before you go, I wanted to just give you the opportunity to talk about feral cats, if you wanted to say anything about that, because I've seen, you know, so many posts, and DOE's been doing a great job on their social media, by the way. I just want to add that. So I feel like I'm keeping very much up to date. So, but I just wanted to give you the opportunity to address that, because I know that's something that's been a hot topic just in the last few days in our community, and people have had various opinions. So I just wanted to give you a chance to address that with our audience before you go.
Yeah. So in terms of feral cats, I mean, this is not a new problem for us. We've been facing this issue for quite a while. And we actually did some work a while back on Little Cayman with the Department of Agriculture and some external help from the UK, where we did make some inroads into trying to reduce the numbers of truly feral cats. We don't have any desire to affect people's companion cats or pet cats. We want to make sure that those animals, anywhere that we're going to try to remove feral cats from the situation, that those animals are microchipped, which we did last time, so that we can always know whether we've inadvertently caught a companion cat as opposed to a truly feral cat when in our traps, for example, when we are trapping. Recently, the issue that we've had is that Feline Friends and the Humane Society basically took some legal action that stopped the Department of Agriculture and the Department of Environment from implementing the trapping program because there were certain things that were not in place in terms of the Department of Agriculture needed regulations to specify the chemicals that they could use for euthanasia and that sort of thing. This part of it gets really complicated.
Right.
Anyways, we've been trying to work through the issues with them. And I'm hoping that we're very close to agreeing something that allows us to get back to taking action, because we continue to lose breeding populations of our brown booby, for example, in Cayman Brac. We've lost adult breeders. We've lost chicks. We've lost chicks in the red-footed booby colony over in Little Cayman. Our hatchling sister islands, rock iguanas, and our blue iguanas. We have had cameras out in the Salina, for example, here, where we release hatchlings. And we've had evidence of feral cats in the Salina predating on these hatchlings, catching that actually live on camera, as well as on Little Cayman. So the impact of cats, I think there's a lot of publications worldwide generally about the effect that cats can have on wildlife. And on islands, it's a particularly serious problem. Some species have been driven to extinction because of this.
Right.
So it is not an insignificant problem. It is a huge problem for us, and we have to get to grips with it. So what we want to do is to do this in as humane a way as possible, and in a way that allows owners of cats to continue to own them and enjoy them as pets, but to do so responsibly, to ensure that they keep them inside, actually, is the best recommendation that we have. Because although your pet is well fed, it's well cared for, it has excellent veterinary care, their instinct to hunt does not go away.
Right.
So trapping and spaying and neutering cats and then re-releasing them into the environment, all that does is stop the reproduction, reproduction of more feral cats. It doesn't stop the impact of those cats in the wild, because they continue to hunt, and even your pet will hunt.
She brings me a lizard every now and then. So yes, I understand.
Yeah. So it is a very, obviously this is a very emotive issue for a lot of people.
And parrot was another one that was recently on that list.
We even had evidence of a feral cat actually getting a parrot in a tree. They are just ultimately, living their lives. They're acting out what they're supposed to do.
Yeah.
And that does not always mean that it's in the best interest of the native wildlife in a country, and particularly on small islands.
Right. Gotcha. Okay. Well, thank you so much for that. I appreciate the update on all of those impromptu topics that I put you through. All right, Gina.
Okay. All right.
Okay, thank you
nice
very
to
much.
Chat with you.
You too. And have a wonderful weekend. All right, guys. So we're going to take our last break for this part of Crosstalk for today, for Friday, and then we'll come back and we'll just kind of wrap up where we're at and let you guys know what's happening on Monday and maybe a couple things going on through the weekend. I did hear quite a few. Oh, yeah, I do have some announcements to make for you guys. So just hang in there. I'll be right back with more Crosstalk after this.
Crosstalk will be back to leading gay man's conversation shortly on Rooster 101.
When it comes to bringing your vision to life, our team of designers here at Compass Print are here to help. Whether it's business cards, wedding invitations, flyers, or programs, we got you covered. We've expanded our custom print services, which allows us to perform quick turnarounds along with unique print projects never seen in the Cayman Islands. Our brand new jet varnish printer that allows us to perform a wide variety of varnish and embellishment projects. Print with reflective foils, tangible textures, and glossy surfaces. Forge collectibles, not lifeless paper. Create memories, not nuisances. Raise the standard of old print designs and eliminate the hassle of overseas services. Contact us today. Email us at printshop@compassmedia.ky or call 949-5111 for more details.
Cold case. It's a phrase no investigator likes to stamp on a crime file. Here in the Cayman Islands, there are at least 20 such cases. Join us at the Cayman Compass as we bring you a special investigative series in partnership with the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service, shining the light on Cayman's cold cases.
for a limited time. Drive-thru open until midnight and 1 a.m. on weekends.
Gay Man Crosstalk is leading Gay Man's Conversation. Be a part of the conversation now. Call 233-1019.
Okay. All right. We're wrapping up Friday, so we just got a few more minutes in the show. Let me tell you what else is going on. So, of course, I've already discussed the Esprit Retreat that I'm going to start with my weekend with. It's a three-day retreat starting tonight, so I'm looking forward to that. All kind of, you know, face mask making, journaling, how to live your best life, yoga, all kind of stuff. All kind of healing from mind, body, and soul. So I am definitely looking forward to that glow up this weekend. What else is going on? There's, and these are things a couple people have asked me to just make sure I announce on their behalf. There is an art exhibit by Orville Richardson, and it's also being hosted by Coach Corey. That's happening October 9th. That's tomorrow from 6 to 10 p.m. at Central Terrace. So it's called Cayman Canvas Art Exhibit by Orville Richardson, and that's at Central Terrace / Mojo Gastro Pub. And let's see. Cayman, sorry guys, hold on. I'm doing this off my phone, so you gotta bear with me. The Cayman Astronomical Society for stargazing. That's the other thing. You can join the Cayman Islands Astronomical Society for an evening of stargazing over the southern skies from 6:30 p.m. on Friday, the 8th of October, from the Spots Dock landing. So if you come just before 7 o'clock, it looks like the International Space Station is going to be over there as well. You're going to also be able to look at Jupiter, Saturn, and Venus will be brilliantly shining in the sky, along with a crescent moon. Also the Sagittarius cluster, a collection of tens of thousands of stars that appear like diamonds split over over velvet, should look amazing. Yeah, that should look pretty amazing. All right, so you can just rock up and join them. It's totally free. So, you know, these are things that you can just take part in your community, guys. So that's happening tonight, is the stargazing starting at 6:30 at Spots Dock. And then if you want to take in some art and hang out with Coach Corey, you can do that over at Mojo in Central Terrace. That's over by, I think, Bayshore, the mall with the stingrays over by the waterfront there. So it's upstairs. I think it's on top of the Cartier building. So I'm just trying to give you guys a good location. It's a little tucked away. It's a nice little gem of a place. If you know, you know. It's like great food. Brigida's wonderful. So big shout out to her. She's always supporting local artists in our community as well. So go hang out with them. Have a blast. You know, she always has great specials going on when she has these events as well. So that's a community update, community calendar, and make sure you're picking up the compass for this scavenger hunt that is going to be happening as well over by the Cayman Turtle Center. See, we brought the turtles back. We brought all the turtle conversation. It comes back around, right? So, okay, guys, that's all the announcements I have. Let me just see if there's anything else I need to quickly update you guys on, or if there's any comments in the chats before I head out. Sometimes I get all caught up in closing the show that I don't see those last little comments. All right, so remember that if you want to get your vaccines, that's going to be happening today at Lions Center, 8:30 until 4:30 p.m. with a quick break at 12 to 1:30. And last but not least, let me get out of here. A lot of buttons. Okay, we had one birthday. All right, see, I was going to give up on y'all. But so a big shout out to O'Neill. He said, good morning, Miss Chanda. Yesterday was my birthday. Well, a big happy birthday to you, O'Neill. Have a wonderful birthday weekend. And we'll hook you up. After the show, I'll hook you up with some gift certificates to Walk and Roll. And let me just check over on Facebook. Anything else? Nope. Okay. So remember, the healthcare conference is going on. If you want to click into that, it is healthcareconference.ky. Nice and simple. We like it easy like that. Just nice and straightforward. Healthcareconference.ky. On Monday coming up, we'll have our Medical Mondays. We'll see what else we need to discuss. What other political happenings are going to be popping. So the other big question, and I didn't get to discuss this, but I'll look for the answers, but this came up yesterday during the opposition conversation, was if we can ask the opposition if they support the vaccine mandate for Caymanian frontline workers. So I'll do a little bit more research and digging, but great questions. Again, we want to know where people stand. We did hear the opposition say that they were, you know, that they were very much for the vaccines and encourage people to get them, but they do respect people's choices. So, you know, we'll see as time unfolds exactly where people stand. But that's a great question. It's the next big one that we're having to be looking at is, you know, what's going to be happening with frontline workers. Are there going to be requirements for frontline workers to be vaccinated? And that might be where it gets starts to get a little bit more heated again. All right, guys. So I think that's about it. I'm just checking in with Lenny. Lenny, anything else you want to add? Lenny's good. We're getting ready to enjoy our weekend. We're counting down in like 15 seconds. This show is ending. All right, guys. So again, just encouraging you all to take really good care of yourself, and you know, life is precious. Sometimes it's too long, sometimes it's too short, depending on, you know, whether you're enjoying it or not. But I just want to, you know, encourage you guys to embrace the good things, take care of yourself, look out for your health, stay hydrated because it's hot out there, hot as heck. So, you know, drink your water and take good care of yourself, and let's try and take care of our community and each other. So on that note, have a wonderful weekend, and I will see you guys bright and early on Monday for more Crosstalk. This is Chanda V, signing out.
This is Lady A.
I'm Matt Still.
This is Hunter Hayes.
This is Game A Country. Rooster 101 Georgetown. Owned and operated by Compass Media. And broadcasting live to the most beautiful place on earth, Grand Cayman. Cayman.